This video is about Bernoulli's method, not Bernoulli's principle, Bernoulli's equation, or the Bernoulli differential equation. In fact, lots of things are named after members of the Bernoulli family, but Wikipedia doesn't list Bernoulli's method as one of them. At least at the time of this recording, going to Bernoulli's method in Wikipedia will land you on an empty article. Bernoulli's method is a polynomial root finding algorithm that just uses the coefficients of the polynomial and finds the largest root in magnitude. It's named for Daniel Bernoulli. If you're wondering where he falls in the family tree, he is the son of Johann I. The method was originally published in the 1728 paper, but was also investigated by Euler and Lagrange. The major breakthrough came in 1926 in a paper by Aitken, which I've actually discussed on this channel before in my video on Stephens' method with Aitken's delta squared. The last major advancement came in 1954 by Rutishauer in a paper that I'll discuss at the end of this video. I'll also special mention two great resources that I used when making this video, including Elements of Numerical Analysis by Peter Henrici and Numerical Methods for Roots of Polynomials, specifically Part 2. Bernoulli's method is as straightforward as it gets. Given a polynomial, you pick n arbitrary starting values. I'll discuss how to pick these values later on in the video, but these are the start of a series of x's. Your next x is given by this equation, which just uses the coefficients of a polynomial. And then once you're done, you can evaluate the ratio of each successive x terms to find your root. Let's use as an example of z squared minus z minus 1. Our starting x terms will just be 0 and 1. We plug the coefficients into our equation for x sub n and simplify. Now let's move our q over to the right so we have some space for x and start computing our next term in the series. Using our previous two x's of 0 and 1, we add them to give us 1. Our next two terms in the series are 1 and 1 to give us 2, followed by 2 and 1 to give 3, and the famous Fibonacci sequence. Then we look at our ratios for our x terms, starting with 1 over 1 to give us 1, 2 over 1 to give us 2, 3 over 2 to give us 1.5, followed by 1.6 repeating, 1.6 exactly, 1.625, and eventually 1.618. Plug this into our original polynomial, and we get what is the root of our equation, giving us a value of 0. Let's look at another example of z to the 5th minus 8z to the 4th minus 72z cubed plus 382z squared plus 727z minus 2310. Using our equation for x, plug in all of our coefficients, and simplify. With our first set of starting terms being all zeros except for the last number being 1, we plug in our new value for n, this time 1, and then plug in our values for x's. This simplifies just to be the value of 8. Our value for x sub 2 would just be 8 times 8 plus 72 times 1, giving 136. If we continue our series finding, we get these numbers. Now we can compute our values for q using two values for x's. In this case, 8 over 1 gives us 8. 136 over 8 gives us 17. 1282 over 136 gives us 9.4. And we keep going. Eventually, we get a number of 11. And if you look at the roots of our equation, they are 2 minus 3, 5, minus 7, and 11. You might be asking why this works. Well, we took our polynomial and computed our equation for x. This value for x is known as a recurrence relation, and we can go from our relation back to our original polynomial, which is known as a characteristic polynomial. We'll assume n is a large number, and substitute in x sub n with z to the k. Then plug that into our equation. We can do some extra substitution to write that as z to the k is equal to some constant a times z to the k minus 1 plus another constant b times z to the k minus 2, where these constants are arbitrary. And in fact, once k gets really large, they're not going to matter very much. And we can simplify it to just be z to the k is equal to z to the k minus 1 plus z to the k minus 2. If we then set that equal to 0 and factor out z to the k minus 2, what we're left with is z squared minus z minus 1 equal to 0, which was our original polynomial. But our numbers that we started with were 0 and 1. Does that really matter? What if we start with 5 and 10? Plug them in to compute our series, and then compute our q values, and we still find the number of 1.618. Even if we picked numbers that weren't in our Fibonacci sequence, like negative 9 and 4, we'll still get our largest root. And you might be asking, why does it always converge on the largest root? Starting with our polynomial, let's simplify the problem by assuming that there are n distinct unique roots, r1, r2, etc., where r1 is our single dominant root. Written this way to say that it is larger than all other roots in absolute value. We can do some fancy math to rewrite our equation for x sub n as this equation, multiplying each of our roots raised to powers against constants. These constants aren't going to matter very much, and you'll see why in a moment. When we take our equation for q and replace our x equations with this new one, we can simplify this by extracting r1 from the top and bottom. Then, as n approaches infinity, with r1 being our largest root, in each of these root division fractions raised to an exponent, those values will go to 0, meaning we can simplify our equation to say that the limit as n approaches infinity for our qn is r1, provided that c1 is not equal to 0. The other question you may have is, well, how do you pick your starting x values? And to that, Euler chose an example of picking the values of 1 and 2. He also has another example with starting from the numbers 0, 0, and 1. And in fact, most of the literature actually recommends starting with all zeros and a single 1. In this paper by Bloom, they write that with starting with zeros and a singular 1, it will ensure that C1 is not equal to 0, which is what we want. They also know that the Bernoulli method converges at a linear rate. The properties of Bernoulli's method lead to some questions. For example, it has a linear order of convergence. Well, what if you want to speed that up? It also only finds a single dominant root. But what if there are several dominant? Or what if there's multiplicity? Or what if they were conjugate pairs? What if you wanted to find the smallest root? Let's answer these two questions, starting with the latter. All you need to do is replace P of z with P of 1 over z, and then rewrite it into a standard form, sometimes needing to divide by the leading coefficient. This creates a new polynomial with all the same roots as the original, except every root is now inverted. Here's an example. Your largest root becomes the smallest, and your smallest root becomes your largest. Then you apply Bernoulli's method, and lastly, do not forget to invert your result. Take our earlier polynomial example and replace z with 1 over z. Multiply both sides by z squared to give us this equation, which we can rewrite as negative z squared minus z plus 1. It's then nice to divide it by a leading coefficient, giving you z squared plus z minus 1 equal to 0. Apply Bernoulli's method, and then invert the quotient at the end. Starting from the numbers 0 and 1, here are the results that we get. And our quotient ends up being negative 1.618, which we then invert to give us negative 0.618. And that's our answer. Here is a neat trick to speed up that process. Simply just reverse the order of your coefficients, and then divide by the leading coefficient. This does assume that you're not dividing by zero. Our very long polynomial from earlier, with roots of 2, minus 3, 5, minus 7, and 11, reverse the coefficients and divide them. I didn't simplify, but you could. This gives us roots of 1 half, minus a third, 1 over 5, minus a seventh, and 1 over 11. On to that first question about speeding up convergence, we actually have a solution from an earlier video on Stephenson's method with Aitken's delta squared. Originally, Aitken's delta squared method was created as a way to speed up Bernoulli's method. The way it works is you take three consecutive numbers from our series, this example to 1.5 and 1.6 repeating. Then you compute the finite difference between each successive term, written as delta x. We'll then compute delta squared x, which is the difference of two differences, which you can write this way. Then apply Aiken's delta squared method, plugging in our numbers to give us the value of 1.625. If we had kept iterating on our series of x's, we would have eventually found 1.625. This is the power of the method. It accelerates the rate of convergence. Let us go back to our earlier example and try to speed convergence. Our first three values for q are 2, 1.5, and 1.6 repeating. Compute our differences and our second order differences and plug them into Aitken's delta squared method to compute q sub 3. This gives us the value of 1.625. Here's the thing. We have our equation for q, which then gives us our equation for our next value for x. Simply multiply q3 times x3, giving us the value of 8.125 for our next value for x. A side-by-side comparison between normal Bernoulli's method and Aitken's accelerated version. This saves us 7 iterations on the method. As for those other questions about having several dominant roots, multiplicity, and conjugate pairs, each of these resources has strategies for dealing with just such scenarios. Let's look again at Aitken's paper. In this paper, Aitken extends Bernoulli's method to find all of the roots simultaneously, including real, complex, and dealing with multiplicity, as well as including a way to speed up convergence. In this example, he finds the roots of 15, minus 7, 3, and minus 1. If you're wondering about the weird notation, he uses logarithmic notation, which makes the paper a bit tricky to read. In this other equation he tries to solve, he finds all of the roots, including conjugate pairs. Although that extension to Bernoulli's method is a little bit tricky to read, I actually want to discuss briefly Rutishauer's extension of Bernoulli's method, which also finds all the roots at once, published in a series of papers that also cite Aitken. If you're not able to get those papers, I also recommend this paper by Henrici. The way it works is you take normal Bernoulli's method, and instead of computing just q, it's now a column of q. There's another variable that we're going to add, which is a column of e that starts as all zeros. Our next column for e is given by this equation, simply a difference of q's added with our previous column's value for e. Then use this equation to compute our next column of q's. It has found both of our roots of 1.618 and negative 0.618. Of course, if you actually kept iterating, it ends up finding a value of 0. Huh. Here's another example on our original long polynomial. It finds all of our roots of 11, minus 7, 5, minus 3, and 2. Of course, if you did keep iterating, it ends up becoming very unstable. If you're wondering about those strange equations for E and Q, they give us this property, which is actually the law of equal rhombi, and it gives the method its power, but it also gives it its numerical instability because those e terms get divided, giving very small quotients, which are then multiplied by other numbers. The quotient difference algorithm does find all of your roots at once, although it is unstable in the most basic version. Usually it's used instead for picking initial starting values for Newton's method, Jenkins-Traub, Berchtold's method, Durand-Kerner, and Aberth-Ehrlich. There are ways to fix the stability concerns, and the method even handles complex roots and multiplicity. To briefly go over everything we've talked about, Bernoulli's method was first published in 1728, and it finds the dominant single root of a polynomial, only using the coefficients, with a linear order of convergence. You can use the inverse trick to make it find the smallest root instead of the dominant one. Aitken later published a method to accelerate convergence and find all the roots at once, which can also be done with the quotient difference algorithm. There are fixes for stability and other issues that come up for all of these methods as well. But what if there was another way to find the roots of polynomials, especially one that was built for complex numbers and makes the searching easy? Thank you for watching this video and your continued support on this channel. If you're interested in the ways that Bernoulli's method can be used to find complex roots, let me know in the comments below. Also, I did foreshadow the next video on this channel. Do you know what it's going to be on? Then leave your best guess in the comments.